So, brothers and sisters, the Lord just spoke to me tonight while I was praying, and I began to pray in the spirit. And then, as the Bible says, build up your most holy faith praying in the spirit. Now, what is praying in the spirit? 1 Corinthians chapter 14 tells us, I always have to stop and get into these teachings instead of just saying straight out what the Lord told me. And people that want to hear what the Lord told you, they're the very, you know, and they say, oh, you didn't rush to what the Lord told you to say. They're the very ones who don't know absolutely nothing about what it means to be praying in the Spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 14, we see that praying in the spirits is where you're praying in tongues, not for interpretation, but between you and the Lord, as the Bible tells us in that text. You know, that you're edifying God, you're worshiping the Lord, and then it says pray that you would also interpret. You don't have to have an interpretation when you're praying in the Spirit to God. You're edifying yourself with the Lord privately or in the church at a low voice where other people can't hear you. And you're worshiping the Lord, edifying the Lord, just between you and the Lord, building up your most holy faith. And it says to pray also that you'll receive interpretation, but you do not have to in that case. That's not the same as the gift of tongues. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, spoken loud in the church, and then it requires an interpreter for other people to hear. Otherwise, they would. Paul said that people think, hey, you're crazy. An unbeliever would come in and say, what's going on? There's babbling, and I can't understand anything. No one's edified but you. As Paul said, I'd rather speak five words in a language that everyone understands than, you know, a million words in tongues. If no one can understand it, no one is edified. So, all of that disclaimer being said, sad to say, of the lack of understanding and teaching and education in the church. Sad to say that this stuff should be common knowledge in the body of Christ. So I guess the failure lies with preachers, and the failure lies with people for not reading their Bibles. So, but yet trying to be on YouTube making videos and talking and never even read their Bible to even understand. If you read the New Testament, you would simply read the New Testament on your own and pray about it. These things are mostly crystal clear and very easy to understand. Even children can understand it. As Jesus said, you must become as a little child to enter the kingdom of heaven. So tonight, brothers and sisters, while I was praying in the Spirit, you know, I was pondering that issue as I told you guys about. I was pondering the issue of, you know, what's going on now, because the Lord gives me plans about building orphanages, and then on the other hand, the Lord is saying, you know, that the rapture is near and keeps talking to me about the rapture and the tribulation and all that. So, you know, which is it? I was asking the Lord, you know, well, what is it? You know, is it going to be long, long time from now? Do I need to, you know, or what? So, and I've asked the Lord that several times, and he always comes, you know, I feel always led by the Lord and in my heart, either by impression or by word in my spirit, that the time is not that far off. But anyway, tonight, as I was praying in the Spirit, brothers and sisters, in an unknown language, I just began to speak in English. And I said, I am on my way, came out of my mouth, by the Spirit of the living God. And then as soon as I said it, brothers and sisters, I saw that symbol of Omega, the Greek Omega symbol, boom, flashed in my face as I had a vision, which I, you know, usually when I see stuff from the Lord, I have visions and words together most of the time. And there's lots of different kinds of visions. And I've made videos about this way in the past, just a FYI. An open vision, or sometimes people have a vision, which I've just had barely had one a few times, just for a few seconds, where you're actually caught up and you're like in the scene. And then there's a little bit lower than that, you have a vision that's like you're looking at a color movie, you know. And so the highest level is like you're in it. You're there, like you are literally there, whether in the body or out of the body, I know not, as Paul said, you know. You get caught up to heaven or whatever it is, the Lord is, you have a real vision and you're in it. Or it seems that you're literally there. You're not sure. The second, as I said, the next level is you see like a color TV. With your eye, you know, the first one is open vision. The second one, eyes closed or maybe even open, you see like a TV screen. And then the next level down is you see like what I've usually seen. 99% of the time I see with my eyes closed, I see something. It's usually in a dark background, and then I see it like an X-ray. I see like a gold instead of a white on a brown background or black background, you know, like a chest X-ray. But I see the image is gold, not white, but kind of a brown background, black background. Then boom, I see an X-ray. And then, but in this case, it was a white background and it was a dark colored Greek Omega is what I saw, just FYI. And then sometimes you get an impression in your heart. You know, and then, you know, the Lord is speaking to you, and then sometimes it's an impression in your heart, you know, that you get. And so the Lord can speak to us at all these varying degrees, and there's probably even more than the what I just went over quickly of how we can hear from God. And sometimes you read a Bible verse and it jumps out at you. You know, the Bible verse is quickened. You get a rhema word. A rhema is a word from the Word. The Bible is the Logos, the Word, and then a rhema is a word from the Word. But sometimes the Lord can speak to you a Bible verse. You may hear a "For God so loved the world" in your head. Then you say, "Well, that's John 3:16. For God so loved the world." So you go read it. You know, oh, maybe God is telling me, you know, you can feel it in your spirit. God is emphasizing that He loves the world. He loves everybody. He loves the lost. Or is God emphasizing in you that Bible verse that you need to go evangelize people? You know, it depends on how you receive it, you know. So that's where the impression part comes in. What is the Lord trying to tell you? Why am I getting into this teaching? I don't know. I came on here to make a quick video and to say that the Lord told me, I'm on my way. Very strong. In English, it came out of my mouth, flowing from the river of living water in my belly. John chapter 7. That river of living water was flowing in an unknown tongue, and boom, it came out in English. I didn't need to translate. I didn't get an interpretation like in my spirit, but out of my mouth in English, I'm on my way. And then I saw that Omega symbol instantaneously, just as I said it. Boom. Right in my face. Out of nowhere, just as the words were coming out of my mouth. And then I said in English, after that, I said in English, I am the way. I am the way. I'm on my way, and I am the way. So back to back, brothers and sisters, that is our Lord. One of the names of the Lord Jesus Christ is the way. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. So Jesus is, you know, God is the I am, but specifically Jesus is, He said, I am the bread of life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You know, I am the good shepherd. You know, so referring to the Father is usually I am, but for Jesus, He uses that title, I am, but then He goes into I am the way, the truth, and life. I am the good shepherd. I'm the bread of life. You know, all those different things He proclaimed and pronounced about Himself as God, and this is how God presents Himself, as the good shepherd, as the way, the truth, and the life, you know, as the bread of life, all these things that the Lord gave us in the New Testament, referring to Himself, and also the title of God, I am. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. It's late, and I wanted to connect these videos, and I really had one long sermon. Excuse me, I try to break these down for the benefit of people that don't have that much time. And now there's things that the Lord gave me to connect all the videos I made together. And that's why I usually always end up making one long video, so it's all there in one meet. But anyway, God bless you guys. I'll see if I can splice them together. I love you guys, and the Lord is coming back soon. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The Lord just give me the, you know, His return is so near. We don't know when, brothers and sisters, but it's just so near, this urgency. You need to get ready, brothers and sisters. Perilous times are coming. Perilous times are at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. People need to repent. We need to get out there and be salt and light. Get out there and do God's will. I say that all the time. And the Lord has told me many times He's on the way, but in this way, it was a fresh way. And while I'd been praying in the Spirit, so it was a little bit different and more strong, and I felt the strength of it in the whole, and at the same time too, when I got that, the Holy Spirit just hit me like a ton of bricks, you know, just a blast of the Holy Spirit. You know, it's just, the Lord is on the way. That's all there is to it. I'll be making more videos. God bless you guys. I love you guys. But as I said, there are people that will say to me, well, the Lord's coming back. We don't need to do orphanages. We don't need to, you know, the Lord said, you know, blessed is the servant when a master comes, he finds he's doing a father, you know, doing the Lord, the master's business. It's in Matthew chapter 25. We're not called to just stand outside and stare at the sky. If I'd have listened to what the flesh says, there were men and women in 2011 tell me, oh, don't write a book, don't build orphanages, don't do any of this stuff because the Lord's coming back. And I ignored them because the Lord told me to do it. And I thought the Lord was coming back soon at that time, which is still soon in God's calendar. But, you know, we got to push forward with what we got to do. And we can just keep busy, keep our nose to the grindstone, and still do God's will and push forward because we know not what hour the master doth come. We need to be prepared. He said, blessed is the servant when he comes that the master finds him working. So we need to continue to work in the vineyard, even those who were hired at the 11th hour. They went and worked, and they got the same wage as those who had been working all day. So now is the 11th hour. It's time for you to get out there and do some work. You're still going to get a wage as everybody else. Hey, that's pretty cool. Now that is why the Lord is so cool. He's going to pay even those who got in at the last minute. You know, he even said those who are last will be first and those who are first will be last. God bless you guys.